Let's take a look at some useful expressions and go step by step to break down how they function. To see how the parent attribute works, you can apply it to the child's layer opacity. In this composition, you'll see a planet layer and a moon layer. If you come over to the planet layer, open position, rotation, anchor point, and scale, you'll see them all in the timeline. Now, because the moon layer is parented to the planet layer, you can adjust all of the transform properties and the moon will follow. Now, if I press T to open the opacity property on the planet and adjust this value, the moon doesn't follow. You can fix this by adding a parent attribute to the moon's opacity. So to do this, highlight moon and press T to open opacity and add a new expression to the property. Now move your cursor to the beginning of the default expression and just type the word parent and a period operator. Now when you click away from the expression field, nothing's going to change, and that's because both layers are at 100% opacity. So if you click and drag on the planet's opacity property, you'll see that the moon is matching the value. This is because the parent attribute is looking at the planet layer and then finding the transform opacity property and using the parent's value as its own value. Now, if you unparent the moon layer, the expression is going to give you an error. And this is because it no longer has a parent. So you can take this expression a step further by adding in a condition to check to see if the layer has a parent or not. So to do this, you can place your cursor right before parent in the current expression and begin a conditional statement. So this can start with if space open parenthesis. Now we're going to use an attribute called hasParent. So that's has all lowercase, capital P parent, and then space double equal sign space true close parenthesis, and then space open curly bracket space. I'm going to come to the end of the line and space close curly bracket. So the hasParent attribute is looking to see if the current layer has a parent or not. Now it's going to output a Boolean, so true or false. Now if it's true, it's going to use that parent's transform opacity as we have here. If it's false, we can add an else statement. So go to the next line and type else, space, open curly bracket, space, and we're just going to assign the original value. So value, space, close curly bracket. Now, if you click away from the expression is no longer broken and the moon has a fallback for its own value. So if I set this to 50, the moon is going to take that value because it has no parent. But as soon as I parent it to the planet layer, it's going to match the parent's opacity. Manually fading a layer's opacity in and out can be a pain, especially with many layers. Using the inPoint and outPoint attributes with conditional statements, you can fade quickly and easily with no keyframes. In this composition, you're going to see a planet layer. Let's fade the layer in and out at the inPoint and outPoint of the layer on the timeline. So you can start this by highlighting planet and hitting T to open opacity and add a new expression. I'm going to scroll down the timeline just a bit and open this so we have a little bit more room here. Now to begin the expression, we're going to start on the first line with a variable called fade, all lowercase. This is going to be followed with an equal sign and a value of 1. This value represents the time in seconds to fade the layer in and out. So end that line with a semicolon and move to the next line. On this line, create a variable called fade in, capital I, followed by an equal sign. And now you can build a mathematical statement to calculate the exact time to fade the layer in. This part will use the inPoint and outPoint attributes, which represent the time in seconds of the layer's trim edges on the timeline. So start this with an open parenthesis, followed by time minus inPoint capital P, and then a close parenthesis. This will measure the gap between the current time and the layer's inPoint as it shrinks over time. After the parenthesis, divide by the fade variable we specified earlier. And this is going to output a range from 0 to 1 across that time gap. Now end this line with a semicolon and move to the next line. Now you can start a variable that's very similar to fade in. It's going to be fade out, capital O, followed by an equal sign. Now you can start this one with an open parenthesis, outPoint, capital P, minus time, close parenthesis, divide by fade variable. This line is very similar to the one before it, and it's going to measure the gap between the current time and the outPoint of the layer as it shrinks over time. So you can end this line with a semicolon and move to the next line. Now it's time to create a conditional statement to determine which fade will be used at a specific point in time. So you can begin this with an if statement, followed by an open parenthesis. Now the condition we're looking for is if time is less than inPoint, capital P, plus fade, close parenthesis. Now follow this with an open curly bracket, and then start an ease method. So ease, open parenthesis, fade in as the source, capital I, comma, 0, comma, 1. And close this with a close parenthesis. And we're gonna times this by times value. And finally, close curly bracket. This line takes the fade in output and maps it to an ease function from 0 to 1. It then multiplies the result by the current opacity value. On the next line, create an else if statement, and then open parenthesis, time is greater than outPoint, capital P, minus fade, close parenthesis. Follow this with an open curly bracket, and we're gonna do another ease method, open parenthesis, fade out as the source, capital O, comma 0, comma 1, close parenthesis. And then times this by the current value again. And then at the end of the line, a close curly bracket. This line eases the fade out at the end of the layer. You can also change these ease methods to linear, ease in, or ease out based on your own needs. Now on the final line, we're gonna create one last else statement, open curly bracket, and value for the current property value, and then close curly bracket. So now if you click out of the expression, I'm gonna collapse this back up. Now you'll notice the planet is at zero opacity, and that's because we're at the endpoint of the layer. But if you scrub the timeline over the first second, you'll notice that it's animating from 0 to 100. You can grab the endpoint of the layer and trim it in time, and it will adjust how it animates. Now we also created a fade out, so if you come to the end of the layer, between second 4 and 5, it's animating out from 100 to 0. And same thing here, if you grab the outPoint of the layer and trim it in, and it adjusts where it starts the animation. Sometimes you may want two expressions to affect a single property at a time. Using the linear method, you can map a slider control to seamlessly fade between two expression outputs. In this composition, you'll see a satellite layer, a satellite target layer, and a satellite null layer. You'll also see a control layer at the top of the composition, and it has an orbit blend slider control on it. Now, if you highlight the satellite layer and hit U to look at the keyframes, you'll notice it has position and Z rotation already keyframed, and it's a pretty wild path that it takes around the planet. Now, the goal here is to bring the satellite layer from this crazy orbit into a perfect orbit around the planet using this orbit blend slider. Now the first thing you want to do is add a new expression to the position property and the Z rotation property. Now once you've done that, highlight the control layer so that we can see the orbit blend slider, and then click into the position expression. Now we're going to start the first line with a variable called source, SRC, and then I'm going to follow that with an equal sign. And then you want to grab the expression pick whip and create a reference to the orbit blend slider. So drag it up and let go. And then end that line with a semicolon and go to the next line. So create a new variable called A, and then follow that with an equal sign. And then we want our point A to be the current keyframed value. So you're gonna use value here, and then end that line with a semicolon and move to the next line. This one is, as you guessed it, B, and then equal sign. Now we want the eventual goal of the orbit blend to end up using the satellite target layer. So with your cursor right after B, if you grab the pick whip and drag it up to the satellite target layer and let go, it's going to create a layer reference. After the reference, you're going to add a period operator, and then we're going to use a two world expression. So two world, capital W, and then open parenthesis, open square bracket, and then 0, 0, 0. And after this, you can close square bracket and close parenthesis, and then end the line with a semicolon. This line will calculate the position of satellite target as it rotates the planet in relation to world space. Now, because it's parented to the satellite null, which is driving the rotation, we want to grab the actual position in world space. And this is what the two-world conversion does for us. Now, on the last line, we're going to map the expression with a linear method. So start with linear, open parenthesis, and the input is going to be our source variable, so src, comma, and then the slider range we're going to use is 0, 100, comma. So now that we have our input range mapped, I'm going to add A, comma, B as the output, close parenthesis. So this is the complete expression. We have the first line referencing the orbit blend slider, and then our A point is the current keyframe value, and B is where we want it to be, which is satellite target, and the linear method is mapping those values across the slider's range. So if you click away from the expression, nothing's going to happen, and that's because our slider is at 0. But if I change this slider to 100 and hit enter, the satellite's going to move. And if you RAM preview the scene, you're going to see that the satellite now takes a perfect circle around the planet. And this is because the satellite target is parented to the satellite null layer, which is in the center of the planet's position and has rotation values, which is driving the animation. What if you change the orbit blend to something like 50, which is halfway between? So if you hit enter, you'll see that the satellite is now taking kind of a path that goes halfway between its current value and the value that we want. So now if you throw some keyframes down, I'm just going to come forward in time, click on the control layer, add a keyframe, set this back to 0, and come forward in time and set this to 100. I'm going to hit U so we can see these keyframes. And so now we have the slider going from 0 to 100 across about almost 2 seconds. I'm going to hit F9 to create easy ease keyframes. And now you'll see a nice gradual change between the chaotic path we had before and the perfect orbit that we are trying to achieve. But now you'll notice that the rotation isn't exactly where it needs to be. So the first thing you can do is select this previous expression and Control or Command C to copy it, and then click on the existing expression for the Z rotation and paste over top. I'm going to click in here to open it up a bit and scroll down. Now we have an expression error, and that's because we're referencing a position instead of a rotation. Now to fix this error, we just need to change the reference for B. So I'm going to come up to satellite null and hit R to open up rotation. And we're going to match this to the Z rotation property. So I'm going to click into the rotation expression, and I'm going to highlight this third line after the B. And with this highlighted, I'm going to grab the pick whip, come up to the Z rotation of the satellite null, and let go. Everything else can stay the same, and then you can click away from the expression. Now this will fix the error. And now if you RAM preview the scene, you'll see that the satellite becomes locked to the planet layer. A handy method when working with graphics and templates is the sourceRectAtTime expression. This method is great for adding a dynamically sized shape layer behind an editable text layer. It measures a layer's bounding box dimensions on the X and Y, and then outputs the results. It starts with the method name, sourceRectAtTime, capital R, A, and T, which is followed by an open parenthesis and one argument, which is the evaluated time, and it ends with a closed parenthesis. Immediately after the method is a period operator, and then one of two attributes, width or height. These output the bounding box of X and Y dimensions on the layer. In this composition, you'll see a label layer and a label background layer. You can use sourceRectAtTime to link the size of the background layer to the text layer. Both of these layers are perfectly sized right now, but if you were to change the text contents to something like planet and click away, you'll notice that the box is still the original size, but we want this to change with the text. So the first thing you'll want to do is access the label background and rapidly tap UU to open the edited properties. The one that you're going to want is rectangle path size. So first things first, add an expression. And on the first line, we're going to start with a variable called pad for padding, follow this with an equal sign, and then a value of 80. This value represents the padding around the edges of the background layer in pixels. So end this line with a semicolon, and then move to the next line. On this line, start with a variable called source, src, follow this with an equal sign, and then grab the expression pickwhip tool and come up to label and let go, and end this line with a semicolon. Now the third line is going to be another variable called box, followed by an equal sign. And this variable is going to contain a mathematical statement that will calculate the dimensions. We're going to start the statement with src to reference the label, and then add a period operator, and then you can use the sourceRectAtTime method. So source, rect, capital R, at, capital A, and time, capital T. Follow this with an open parenthesis, and then our evaluated time is going to be time minus source period operator inPoint, capital P. Now you can close this with a closed parenthesis and a semicolon. The sourceRectAtTime method will evaluate the layer specified in the source variable. So that will be your label layer. The evaluated time is time minus source inPoint, and this is used to account for any offset in time between the label and the label background layers on the timeline. Now the final line is going to assemble everything for the two-dimensional size property output. So start this with an open square bracket, and then type a reference to the box variable. So box, period operator, width, plus pad, comma, box, period operator, height, plus pad. Close this with a closed square bracket. Now this line is assembling everything together. So it's taking the source rect at times width and its height, and then adding pad to it, and then outputting it in a two-dimensional array. So if you click away from the expression field, you'll see the background resizes to the planet text layer. And so it's calculating the text layer's dimensions and then adding 80 pixel padding around the sides. And best part is, if you come in here and change this to solar system, the background auto resizes as you type. Now, one last thing I would recommend, I already have it done here, is to parent the label and the label background together, because if they're not parented, you might get something like this, where the label is still affecting the size. We've arrived at the end of lesson 401, an overview of useful expressions for After Effects. If you enjoy this expressions course, consider purchasing the paid content. It includes in-depth documentation, extra tutorial content, high-definition videos, and all the project files used in the training. Your purchase will help to create more free courses like this in the future.